Oh, sorry about that.
That's the manual control.
Yeah. Yeah. Before I move on, there was a quote here that I wanted to add from the last meeting. Yeah, you should write this because this is our instructions here. Remember that this illustration here, this is the wake-up, right? This, we didn't go into depth as to how you explain these things, nor did we go into depth on how to explain the daily, the 1290 and the 1335. Those are just waking people up to their condition so that they can make a decision in what direction they want to go in, right? And the reason why it has to be short and sweet is this. This is from Testimonies, Volume 3. Page 38. It says here, this is a busy world. And Ellen White was writing this in her day. It's busier now, right? Page 38. This is a busy world. Men and women who engage in the business of life have not time to meditate. They don't have time to meditate or to even read the Word of God enough to understand all the important truths. Long-labored arguments will not interest but a few, for the people have to read as they run. And she goes over, if you go to page 37, she goes into detail about how we aren't to make our arguments long. In other words, you may have a long argument, but you don't spend, she says right here, that we're not to give more than a few scriptures on any one subject. That's all that's needed. Okay? And if they're not gonna accept the witness of three, it doesn't matter how many of them you have. So what we have here is that, and fascinating enough, because this segues into our next subject, okay? In the book of Daniel, it says what? That they'll run to and fro, right? How is Ellen White using this? Is it literal or spiritual?
Literal.
It's literal. Let me read this again. This is a busy world. Men and women who engage in the business of life have not time to meditate or to even read the Word of God enough to understand all its important truths. Long-labored arguments will interest but a few. I guess we're part of the few here. For the people have to read as they run. Is that not a direct paraphrase or quote from Daniel chapter 12? It is. And Habakkuk chapter 2. And she's giving it in a literal sense. So at the end of the world, people not only are, it is true, going to and fro in God's Word, but they are literally going to and fro on the surface of this earth. Amen? Okay. I think I'm excited over this next presentation. I've never given this one before. And we'll pray here. But, so bear with me because, you know, I've never given this one before. And hopefully I do, you know, I'm able to illustrate or convey what I'm trying to share. Okay. All right, let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, I pray that you would guide our hearts and minds because we're going to be dealing with an issue, Lord, that is a controversy right now within present truth, within Adventism. And Lord, I pray that you would open our mind to understanding. And if what I'm going to say is not true, I pray that you would open our eyes to what is truth, because I am taking a public stance today on what I believe is truth. And Lord, as I share this message, I pray that you would send your Holy Spirit upon us to guide us in this truth, is my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. What we're going to do, I'm going to reread a quote that I had read earlier. And this quote is from Testimonies, Volume 3, 255. First paragraph. Testimonies, Volume 3, 255. And then I'm going to segue into another quote that's found in Testimonies, Volume 3, page 258. So I'm not going to stop. I'm just going to read the quote, and then I'm going to go right to the quote on page 258, okay? I have been shown that the greatest reason why the people of God are now found in this state of spiritual blindness is that they will not receive correction. Many have despised the reproofs and warnings given them. The true witness condemns the lukewarm condition of the people of God, which gives Satan great power over them in this waiting, watching time. The selfish, the proud, the lovers of sin are ever assailed with doubt. Satan has the ability to suggest doubts and to devise objections to the pointed testimony that God sends. And many think it a virtue, a mark of intelligence in them, to be unbelieving and to question and quibble. Those who desire to doubt will have plenty of room. God does not propose to remove all occasion for unbelief. He gives evidence, which must be carefully investigated, with a humble heart, with a humble mind, and a teachable spirit. All should decide from the weight of the evidence. The word of the Lord spoken through his servants is received by many with questionings and fears. Note that. Fears, okay? Because Ellen White says that when the mighty angel of Revelation 18 comes down, that the people will brace themselves against it. They will fear it. Are you guys familiar with that quote? I can tell you where it is in a minute. The word of the Lord spoken through his servants is received by many with questionings and fears, and many will defer their obedience to the warning and reproofs given, waiting till every shadow of uncertainty is removed from their minds. The unbelief that demands perfect knowledge will never yield to the evidence that God is pleased to give. He requires of his people faith, faith that rests upon the weight of the evidence. Remember we talked about this before? Not upon perfect knowledge. Those followers of Christ who accept the light that God sends, they must obey the voice of God speaking to them when there are many other voices crying out against it. It requires discernment to distinguish the voice of God. Those who will not act when the Lord calls upon them, but who wait for more certain evidence and more favorable opportunities, will walk in darkness. For the light will be withdrawn, the evidence given one day, if rejected, may never be repeated. This is solemn. And so we have a message to give to the world. And this message is so solemn that Ellen White says it's the most solemn message ever entrusted to human beings. And everybody that's in Adventism in this struggle that we're going on as to what is truth and error, we have to lay out the evidence and we have to make our decision based on the weight of the evidence. Okay? And that's what I intend to do today. Okay. And basically, I'm not going to hide this, that there are some within present truth and maybe even some in this room who are going to disagree with what I'm getting ready to share with you. But I'm just weighing out the evidence, okay? And there is a concept and teaching where some people believe that everything that happens after the cross is spiritual and everything that happens before the cross is literal. Are you guys familiar with this concept? And there is truth to that. There are things that happen before the cross that are spiritual, but there are also things that happen after the cross that are literal. Okay? And within present truth, there's been some issues have been brought up in regard to the places in the Bible that it talks about towers. How many people are familiar with this? Okay. So what I want to do is we're going to shift gears. Here we were discussing the midnight cry, okay, in the first presentation. We didn't go into detail, but what we're going to do is we're going to talk about the second angel's message, okay? The second angel's message. And I'll give you the quotes right here, okay? The second angel's message, this is 1T, page 53, paragraph 2. In this quote right here, Ellen White says that the midnight cry and the second angel's message were given together. Okay? So what happens here is, in fact, if you look at how Ellen White lays this whole thing out, is that the second angel's message comes first, and then the midnight cry follows. Okay? And they both were first proclaimed in 1844. Okay? Now, the second angel's message, let's go there. Let's go there. We're going to go to Revelation chapter 14. And verse 8. Chapter 14 and verse 8. In fact, what I'm going to have to do is, these quotes are so important, I think I'm going to have to show them. Yeah. And bear with me here. What's that? Impromptu. That's it. Okay. Let's look at this. Verse 8, and there followed another angel saying, Babylon is fallen, that great city, because she made all the nations drink the wine of the wrath of her fornication. Okay? So here's what's going on. In this message right here, it's talking about the fall of Babylon. And what I'm going to do right now is I'm going to share with you some quotes that Ellen White talks about here, and she gives us a commentary on this verse. We're going to go to GC, Great Controversy, and we're going to go to page 389, and we're going to go to paragraph 2. Actually, you can even put in paragraph 1 if you want. Okay. Now, I'm going to highlight this little area right here so you can all see where I'm starting. You see where the little black line is right here? So this is what Ellen White says. The second angel's message of Revelation 14 was first preached when? In the summer of 1844, and it then had a more direct application to the churches of where? The United States, where the warning of the judgment had been most widely proclaimed and most generally rejected, and where the declension in the churches had been most rapid. But the message of the second angel did not reach its complete fulfillment in 1844. The churches then experienced a what fall? A moral fall, in consequence of their refusal of the light of the Advent message. But that fall was not complete. As they have continued to reject the special truths for this time, they have fallen lower and lower. Not yet, however, can it be said that Babylon is fallen, because she made all nations drink of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. She has not yet made all nations do this. The spirit of the world conforming, the spirit of world conforming and indifference to the testing truths for our time exists and has been gaining ground in the churches of the Protestant faith in all the countries of Christendom. And these churches are included in the solemn and terrible denunciation of the second angel. But the work of apostasy has not yet reached its culmination. Now, when Ellen White writes this in her day, it hadn't. And when the proclamation is first made, it hadn't reached, like she said, to its complete fulfillment, right? Okay. Now, Ellen White is saying that this message has a direct application to who?
USA.
To the United States. Isn't that fascinating? A direct application to the United States. Now, what happens is, for those of you that don't know, another angel comes down from heaven and reiterates the second angel's message. Are you guys familiar with that? Let's turn to Revelation chapter 18. Revelation chapter 18, and we're going to start at verse 1. Because this is what we're to be proclaiming, right? The second angel's message. Revelation chapter 18. And after these things, this is verse 1, and after these things I saw another angel come down from heaven, having great power, and the earth was lightened with his glory. And he cried mightily with a strong voice, saying, Babylon the great is fallen, and is become the habitation of devils, and the hold of every foul spirit, and the cage of every unclean and hateful bird. For all nations have drunk of the wine of the wrath of her fornication. Now here's the interesting point. Notice right here. I want to highlight this quote right here from Ellen White. Okay, I'll read it. She says here, she has not yet made all nations do this. What has she not made all nations do? Drink of the wine drink the wine of the wrath of her fornication. But here in Revelation 18, verse 3, it says, for all nations what? Have. What does have mean? That means it's done, right? So when this Revelation chapter 18, verse 3, becomes fulfilled, then that means that Babylon has what? Fallen. And according to Ellen White, what is the fall? It's a moral fall. So the moral fall starts in 1844 because they reject the light. And it continues to fall more and more until it's fully morally what? Fallen. So Ellen White, did you know that she tells us, God gives her a prophecy, and she actually gives us the event when this moral fall would be complete? Okay? We're going to go to periodicals, RH. RH. July. 5. 1906, paragraph 12. Okay, here's where she tells us that Revelation 18, 1 through 3 has been fulfilled. I'm going to start right here. How comes the word that I have declared that New York is to be swept away by a tidal wave? This I have never said. I have said, as I looked at the great buildings going up there, story after story, what terrible scenes will take place when the Lord shall arise and shake terribly the earth. Then the words, of Revelation 18, 1 through 3 will be fulfilled. No, it says they will be fulfilled. The whole of the 18th chapter of Revelation is a warning of what is coming on the earth. But I have no light in particular in regard to what is coming on New York, only that I know that one day the great buildings there will be thrown down by the turning and overturning of God's power. From the light given me, I know that destruction is in the world. One word from the Lord, one touch of his mighty power, and these massive structures will fall. Scenes will take place, the fearfulness of which we cannot imagine. So in 1844, you have the second angel message is given. Babylon has fallen, but that message is not a complete fulfillment. And Ellen White says so. It's not a complete fulfillment, and it has a direct application to where? The United States. But when this second, the fourth angel comes down and reiterates the message that Babylon has fallen, according to Ellen White, when this angel comes down, that it is what?
Complete.
Fulfilled. Okay? Does that mean that Babylon is done for? No, it's moral. Friends, let me ask you a question. Is there really any honest Christian, doesn't matter the denomination, that you could ask, has the United States of America morally fallen, yes or no? I mean, have we completely morally fallen? I don't know about that. Can you get any worse? What's that?
I think we can,
but what I'm saying is we're to the point here where this nation is so morally corrupt and bankrupt that, I mean, it's just like, how many people here, I mean, not to get into any kind of political thing, but how many people really have any hope for the future for this nation? I mean, the United States is on the what? On the decline, both economically, morally, ethically, spiritually, everything that you can imagine, we're on the slide, right? Isn't that true? So we've fallen. Our zenith as a nation, when we've finally rejected these truths, you're done. Now notice this. Ellen White says here that only verses 1 through 3 are fulfilled. Not the rest of the chapter. The rest of the chapter is a warning of what is coming. It does get worse. It does. Look over here at verse 6. Revelation 18, verse 6. And just look at this quote right here. Reward her even as she rewarded you, and double under her, double according to her works, in the cup which she has filled, fill to her double. Friends, you know how good we've lived in this country? And we're told, as reward her even as she rewarded you, and double unto her, double according to her works, in the cup in which she hath filled, fill to her double. Man, it's going to be some tough times here. And, well, I'm not going to go into this, but I was going to put a plug in right here for country living because, friends, there's some things that are getting ready to come down on this world. And if you're in highly populated areas, and how many people know this, that Ellen White says that the areas where the most sin takes place is going to be the areas of the most devastation. You know what I'm saying? So it's like you want to be as far away from the centers of crime and sin as you can possibly be. Okay? Now, here's the thing. Ellen White is telling us here that the fall of Babylon, that the Lord sends a message, okay? That the Lord sends a message to his people that when the buildings of New York fall, that Revelation 18, 1 through 3 is fulfilled, okay? And this is the reiteration of the second angel's message. It's telling us that we're somewhere in time. This is telling us where we are in prophetic history. But how do we share this message with non-Seventh-day Adventists. Let me explain something. If you are a Seventh-day Adventist and you're trying to share this message with your neighbor, can you go to them and say, hey, look at this quote from Ellen White? Right? They do like the chart. And you know what? If you do a study on Spirit of Prophecy and stuff, you can use Ellen White's writings, right? But Ellen White is a counsel to the Laodiceans, isn't she? Okay? And when we go forth at the Sunday Law to proclaim the loud cry, what's going to be our main weapon? Right here. The writings of Ellen White are to assist us in that battle. She's like, you understand what I'm saying? It's to get us familiarized with these quotes right here. And to get us ready physically, morally, spiritually. We're like in basic training, isn't that right? You know, we eat a certain way, we exercise a certain way, we drill. You know, we drill. We're preparing for the battle ahead, right? So, this is where things get controversial in this little meeting right here. Because in this debate over spiritual, literal, the question is, if everything after the cross is spiritual, then we kind of have a challenge. And the challenge is that let's just go through some basic Adventist historical facts. In 1755, was there a literal great earthquake?
Yes, there was.
There was. Is that found in the book of Revelation?
Yes.
After the cross, before the cross?
After
the cross. In 1780, was there a literal dark day? After the cross, before the cross? Was there literally a day when the moon turned to blood in 1780?
Yes.
Literal? Spiritual. Okay. But here's the thing. If you go back into Ellen White's writings in the Great Controversy and read about the dark day, do you know she actually says that the dark day came when the world was in spiritual darkness? So there is a spiritual application, but there is a literal event that happened. Okay? In 1833, when the stars fell from the heavens, yes, sir?
It was predicted as a ritual event after the cross. So it doesn't even fall into the category before the cross, or after, because it was predicted. Even spiritual applications have a ritual fulfillment depending on the context of the prophecy.
Amen. Okay, but let's put it this way. In the book of Joel, the Joel predicts the dark day. So the prophecy in the book of Joel about the day, the sun being blotted out and the moon turning to blood, was written before the cross, but it reaches a fulfillment after the cross. Amen? Okay, so is that fulfillment that was written before the cross, was it literally fulfilled after the cross? Right. And I'm not saying that everything necessarily has a literal fulfillment.
But was the Day of Atonement predicted before the cross or after? Of course, its prediction was before the cross to be fulfilled after.
Amen.
Just like Joel's dark day. But there's what you mean by dark day. The day of the Lord is a day of judgment before it's the Sunday law. It depends what judgment, what day of the Lord. So the term is.
So let's look at it like this. He's not picking it up. So let's give another illustration here. When it comes to what we read earlier in the Spirit of Prophecy, where she says that people will run as they read it, right? She's making a parallel there between Habakkuk and Daniel, right? Now, we have a spiritual understanding where running to and fro means running to and fro in God's Word. But notice that Ellen White also makes an application that it's a literal event, that people at the end of the world are so busy that they literally are running to and fro. Isn't that true?
Yeah.
Okay. So what this has to do with is that here we are, we have the second angel's message, we have a prophet that gives us this quote here that tells us that at the end of the world, that these buildings are going to fall down, and that these buildings are so significant that they tell us that the second angel's message arrives back in sacred history, right? And if we have this gospel, the everlasting gospel, that's to go to every nation, kindred, tongue, and people all over the face of the earth, and Ellen White, which I read earlier, that the message is supposed to be given so plainly and so simply that we're to lay out all the evidence that this, in fact, has happened. Amen? So how are we going to do this and use the Bible only, based on the historical effects as they've how they have transpired? And that's what I'm going to do today. I'm going to just lay out the evidence, and this is where it gets controversial, because what I'm going to say here is that when it comes to the towers in the book of Isaiah and the book of Zephaniah, that the use of these words is literal. Okay? And I'm just going to lay out the evidence. Okay? So, according to the rule of first mention, if we want to understand what the tower means, we have to go back to where? We have to go back to Genesis. We have to go back to Genesis. Genesis chapter 11. And we're going to read this little story here about what happened after the destruction of the world. Genesis chapter 11. Genesis chapter 11, verse 1. And we're going to kind of read this through, and then we're going to kind of go back and pick it apart. Okay? Genesis chapter 11, verse 1. And the whole earth was of one language and of one speech. And it came to pass as they journeyed. Does it say to the east or from the east? From the east. So if you're journeying from the east, which direction are you going? West. So it came to pass as they journeyed from the east that they found a plain in the land of Shinar. And they dwelt there. And they said one to another, "Go to, let us make brick and burn them thoroughly." And they had brick for stone, and slime they had for mortar. And they said, "Go to, let us build us a city and a tower, whose top may reach unto heaven, and let us make us a name, lest we be scattered abroad upon the face of the whole earth." And the Lord came down to the sea, the city and the tower, which the children of men builded. And the Lord said, "Behold, the people is one, and they have all one language, and this they begin to do, and now nothing will be restrained from them that they have imagined to do." Okay? So here's the first use of the word tower in the Bible. Okay? Now, let me ask you a question. This was the first tower ever built, right? Okay. If this is the first tower ever built, and any tower that's built after that and uses the term tower is relying on that as an example, isn't it? Okay. So, according to the Bible, what was the reason they built the tower? We know all this spirit of prophecy wise, but what does the Bible say? To make a name for themselves. So the primary reason that they built this tower is to make a name for themselves. Hold on a second. I'm looking for a couple quotes I had.
Bible has a reference that's not from the east, but eastward.
See, there's a difference. But since we're Seventh-day Adventists, and in addition to trying to give an illustration how to share the second angel's message with non-Adventists, there is an issue at hand, and Ellen White brings this out here. So I am going to interject this right now. This is from CC, Courage and Conflict, page 42. And it's chapter 36. It's called God Comes Down to See. And she says here, they said, come let us build ourselves a city and a tower with its top in the heavens, and let us make a name for ourselves, lest we be scattered abroad upon the face of the whole earth. And here's what she goes on to say. For a time the descendants of Noah continued to dwell in the mountains. In fact, do you guys want me to bring this up on the screen so you can see it? Okay, let's do that. Courage and conflict. Conflict and courage, rather. Sorry.
Conflict and courage?
Uh-huh. CC.
And what page?
Page 42. Yeah, and you can find this in other places. There it is, right here. God comes down. Okay. For a time, the descendants of Noah continued to dwell among the what? The mountains. This is key. I want you to remember this, because in present truth, we believe what the book of Isaiah says. We believe that the Lord illustrates the end from what? The beginning, right? So the end of the world the last time is going to illustrate the end of the world this time, right? We're going to put together here a chiastic structure, okay? For a time, the descendants of Noah continued to dwell among the mountains where the ark had rested. Okay? So, let's put our mind around this. The world is destroyed. Okay? And we're going to the future where the world will be destroyed again. Right? And so, what happens after the world is destroyed the first time, where are they living? In the mountains. So at the end of the world, just before the world is destroyed again, where will we be living?
In the mountains.
You see the chiastic structure here? And that's where we're gonna go along these lines here. Okay? Where the ark had rested. As their numbers increased, apostasy soon led to division. Those who desired to forget their Creator and to cast off the restraint of His law felt a constant annoyance from the teaching and example of their God-fearing associates. Does that sound familiar? After a time, they decided to separate from the worshipers of God. I want to stop right here. If the Lord illustrates the end from the beginning, who separates from who? What's that? Well, no, let's read this again. Those who desired to forget their Creator and cast off the restraint of His law felt a constant annoyance from the teaching and example of their God-fearing associates. After a time, they decided to separate from the worshipers of God. So who separates from who? The wicked separate from the godly, right? Now, I'm not going to get into it because, you know, you can be separated by being kicked out. Amen? I mean, you know, there's different things here, but we're told that in the spirit of prophecy that when the shaking comes to its fullest, it's them who are shaken out, isn't it? Okay. Now, they decided to separate from the worshipers of God. Accordingly, they journeyed to the plain of Shinar. Now, if you do take the word Shinar and you do proof texting in the Bible, where do you think it takes you to?
Babylon.
On the banks of the river Euphrates. Where was Babylon built? Here they decided to build a city. And in it a tower for such stupendous height as should render it the wonder of the world. So They're building this tower, and it's going to be a wonder of the world, right? The dwellers on the plain of Shinar disbelieved God's covenant that he would not again bring a flood upon the earth. Many of them denied the existence of God and attributed the flood to the operation of natural causes. Are we seeing this here? Are we seeing this? I mean, the Lord is revealing the end from the beginning. Isn't this exactly what's going on today? Others believed in a supreme being and that it was he who had destroyed the antediluvian world, and their hearts, like Cain, rose up in rebellion against him. Now, I want to stop right here. Were there two classes of people here among those that didn't believe in God? Or the evil ones? So you had the ones that were true, and where were the true ones living? They're living in the mountains, and the ones that aren't true are living where? Land of Shinar. Okay? Now here's the thing. In this land of Shinar, you have two people, the two groups of evil people. One group of either evil people, they don't even believe in the existence of God. And they're saying, no, these things happened on their own. Naturally. The other group, they did believe in the supreme being, but they chose what? They chose the path of Cain, right? Does she talk about any other people in that group right there? This is important. Well, this group right here, she's saying here that you have in the two groups, one doesn't believe in God at all, and the other one does believe in the supreme being. But like Cain, they have this what? Rose up in rebellion against him. That's found right here, in this area right here. Okay? One object before them in the erection of the tower was to secure their own safety in case of another deluge. Now, this is interesting here. Because they were preparing for some cataclysmic event, potentially, right? Isn't it on the minds of everybody in the world right now that just something, we're on the edge of something, really? By carrying the structure to a much greater height than was reached by the waters of the flood, they thought to place themselves beyond all possibility of danger. And as they would be able to ascend to the regions of the clouds, they hoped to ascertain the cause of the flood. Do you know we do that today? We're doing all kinds of studying, studying global warming, and we're studying all this and all that, trying to find out why all these things are happening. It's sin. Amen? But they're trying to figure it out, right? She goes on to say, there are tower builders in our time. Notice this. She uses this in a spiritual connection here. There are tower builders in our time. Infidels construct their theories from supposed deductions of science and reject the revealed word of God. In the professedly Christian world, many turn away from the plain teachings of the Bible and build up a creed for human speculations and pleasing fables. And they point to their tower as a way to climb to heaven. She's using this in a spiritual application, but she's going to turn on a dime here. Watch this. The time of God's investigation is at hand. She's using this in relation to these towers, right? The Most High will come down, and she's talking about in the future, the Most High will come down to see that which the children of men have builded. His sovereign power will be revealed. The works of human pride will be laid low. Okay? Now, excuse me with my notes here. We're going to go to Christ Triumphant. CTR. And we're going to go to page We're going to bring page 70. Paragraph 2. Okay. Mrs. White says here, the schemes of the Babel builders ended in shame and defeat. The monument to their pride became the memorial of their folly. Okay? And I wanted to put this quote out here because, and I have many others along the same lines, that over and over and over again, the spirit of prophecy is indicating the reason why that tower was built. And it has to do with what she says here, the monument to their pride. It was self-exaltation. Just like the Bible says in Genesis chapter 11, they built the city and the tower to make a name for themselves. Okay? And that's where the controversy really begins, because I'm going to use an application that at the end of the world, that it's this pride, this gadol, that has crept into, not crept into, it is part of our fabric, part of our national fabric as a people. And that I'm going to make the application here in the Bible that the word tower is a literal tower. Okay? And then I'm going to lay out the evidence. Is that fair enough? Okay. So what we're going to do here is I'm going to do a PowerPoint presentation. And that down here, Bill? F5? Okay. Shift F5. Okay. So if you notice, can everybody see this board? No?
Yeah, if you stand there.
All right, I'll stand as far back as possible. What's in the way? Can you see that? Can you see the screen?
Can the camera see it?
Put your camera down here. I put your laptop.
If you put the laptop on the bench and move the podium for a minute.
Okay.
Down.
Oh, my bad. Yeah, thank you. That's a good one. How's that? All right, we're cooking with gas now, right? All right, what are we doing? What, I must have hit a button here. Okay, so what we're going to do here, okay. All right, I'll just look over periodically. Okay, as you notice here, there are two blue lines on the screen. And you see what that says right there? That's the end of the world. That's the end of the world the first time, because we're doing a chiastic structure here, okay? A chiastic structure is like a mirror, okay? So if the first blue line represents the end of the world the first time, what does the second blue line represent? Amen. So that's the end of the world the second time. Okay, in the story of the flood, after the world is destroyed by a flood, what is the first thing that God does as a sign to Noah? There it is. He makes a rainbow. He enters into covenant with his people. Amen? And he tells them that the world will never be destroyed again by a flood. Right? Now, according to Great Controversy and in the Bible, when Jesus comes back, what does he come back with?
A rainbow.
There it is. So when he descends out of the clouds, he has a rainbow around him. In addition to that, we're told in the spirit of prophecy that there will be a rainbow encircling every praying company. Have you ever read that? Amen. Well, now, after the rainbow happened, where did Noah and his family set up their home?
In the mountains.
There you go. They set up their home in the mountains. And in a perfect chiastic structure, where will God's family be setting up their home in the end of the world?
In the mountains.
In the mountains, right? Okay. When the people that were living in the mountains went into apostasy, where did they go? They built a city. There it is. See it way down there at the bottom? Do you see it? Okay, can you see? Okay. So they built a city. Now, at the end of the world, what's that?
I said New Age architect.
Yeah. Well, we don't really know what it looked like, right? Now,
it didn't look like that.
Well, if you get closer, it's those are like flagpoles and stuff, right? So what happens is that when we come to the mountains, where are many of God's people coming from? The city. Does that look like our city?
Yeah.
One of our cities? Okay. Now, so here's the thing. After they built the city, then what did they build? They built this city, and this city became known as what?
Babylon.
Now, at the end of the world, according to Revelation chapter 18, there's going to be another city that's going to be called Babylon the Great. Amen? Okay. So the first city was Babylon, which means confusion, and the last city at the end of the world means Babylon the Great. It means greater confusion, right? Isn't that what it means? Okay. So what happens is they built a tower. Okay? So let me ask you a question right here. The Bible says that before this period happened, that the world was one language, right?
Yep.
They were one people, one language, one people, right? Isn't that true? And they journeyed from where? No, they journeyed from the east unto the west, right? From the east to the west. Is there any story in the history of the world where people journeyed to a city from the east unto the west, and that people from every nation, kindred, tongue, and people went to this one specific city? What's that? New York City. We call it what? It's a melting pot, right? Isn't it a melting pot? In fact, where's the capital of the United Nations?
New York City.
If you read online, you go online or get a history book, and you read about how the city of New York came into being, you'll see that people came from all over the world to come to this one place. And when it was established, it wasn't established by one ethnic group, even though the Dutch technically found it, okay, under Sir Henry Hudson, who was an Englishman, who the Dutch hired to be an explorer. But what happens is when they come there, they're all this, it's multinational, okay? And they come to this city, and again, friends, I'm just laying out the evidence, right? I'm just laying out the evidence. So they come to this city, and do they build towers in this city? They do. Now, let me ask you a question. According to Testimonies, Volume 9, page 11 and 12, when Ellen White is in what city?
New York
City. She's called upon to look at buildings rising higher and higher. And she says they were built to glorify what? Their builders. Amen? Okay. So why was the Tower of Babel built? And why were the World Trade Center built? You see the chiastic structure here? Okay. Now, Let's take a look at the Bible here. In Genesis chapter 11, in Genesis chapter 11, verse 7, the Bible says, go to, Genesis 11, verse 7, go to, let us go down. Okay? Do you see that? Now, look at verse 5. And the Lord came down. The Lord came down. Right? So, you see where I put comes down right there? Okay. So, when the Lord came down, what did he come down to do? Right? So, he comes down. Just like that. You like that little effect there? He comes down to the tower. Right? Yeah. That was Bill. That wasn't me. Now, in order for this to be a perfect chiastic structure, when the Bible talks to us about the great buildings of New York at the end of the world, or this place called Babylon the Great, let's go to Revelation chapter 18 and see what the Bible says. Revelation 18. So remember, in Genesis, God comes down, right? So in Revelation chapter 18, verse 1, it says, and after these things, I saw another angel do what? Come down. You see the chiastic structure here? So God comes down, and then in the end of the world, this mighty angel comes down. Yes. So what happens here is we're looking at literally the Lord revealing to us the end from the beginning. And why does the city, the great Babylon, have two buildings instead of one that the Lord visits? Because two is greater than one, right? It's double the confusion. Let me put things like this. When they journeyed to the land of Shinar and they said, we're going to build the greatest building the world has ever seen, right? At the end of the world, when they build these two buildings, they said, we're going to build this greatest city, the greatest building the world has ever seen, and we're going to build two of them. That's real human pride. Isn't it? Now, let's look at the rest of the controversial text. We're going to go to, let's see. Let's go to Zephaniah chapter 1. Zephaniah chapter 1. And I'm not saying here that the Bible doesn't have dual application. Isn't that true? Does the Bible have dual application? Or even triple application? But what I'm saying here, that the primary application for the word tower and the use of the word tower is self-exaltation. And we're going to get into this even more. Now what we're going to look at is, we're going to look at verse 16, Zephaniah chapter 1 and verse 16. Zephaniah chapter 1 and verse 16. And again, I'm just laying out evidence. If you, you know, have something else to share with me, let me know. But I'm just laying out the evidence because we're talking about one of the greatest important events in human history that's a turning point of judgment for God's people. Certainly there's going to be an event, a tangible event, like the stars falling or the dark day, to illustrate to God's people that we are where we are. Isn't that true? Amen. Verse 16. Well, maybe I should go back a little bit. Verse 12 we'll start at. Verse 12. And it shall come to pass at that time that I will search Jerusalem with candles, and punish the men that are settled on their lees, that say in their hearts, the Lord will not do good, neither will he do evil. Therefore their goods shall become a booty, and their houses a desolation. They shall also build houses and not inhabit them. They shall plant vineyards, but not drink the wine thereof. The great day of the Lord is near, it is near, and hasteneth greatly, even the voice of the day of the Lord. The mighty man shall cry there bitterly. That day is a day of wrath, and a day of trouble and distress, a day of wasteness and desolation, a day of darkness and gloominess, and a day of clouds and thick darkness. A day of the trumpet, an alarm, against the fenced cities, and against the high towers. I will bring distress upon men, and they shall walk like blind men, because they have sinned against the Lord, and their blood shall be poured out as dust, and their flesh as dung. And I want to enter one thing here, because I don't want to tackle this issue about the day of the Lord. My personal opinion is that the day of the Lord is not a singular day. The day of the Lord does not encompass one singular day. It's not 9/11 only. It's not the Sunday law only. It's a series of events that takes us all the way to Jesus coming in the clouds of glory. Okay? In fact, we believe that the time of the end began in 1798. Isn't that true? Okay. Now, those that look at this word towers are interpreting it as the Sunday law, okay? And what I'm not saying that there can't be an application to that, but what I'm saying is that the primary application is talking about when at the end of the world, when judgment starts falling out on God's people, that God sends them a warning. Okay, and not only that, he's telling us that the second angel's message has arrived back in sacred history. Verse 16, a day of the trumpet. Now, you see this chart right here? As Seventh-day Adventists, we believe that we've been under the sound of the seventh trumpet since October 22nd, 1844. So, are we living in the day of the trumpet, yes or no? Amen. So, can I check that one off? No matter where you stand in this argument, it is the day of the trumpet, right? And an alarm against the fenced cities and against the high towers. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to work backwards from the towers and then explain the fenced cities. Is that okay? Since this is the first time I've done this, I can't remember what's the next slide, so it'll be a surprise to all of us. Now I remember what it is. What I want to share with you, some may not know this, but some of you may. In my research on this presentation, and I've known this for a little while, how many people are familiar with the Greek historian Herodotus? Is it Herodotus or Herodotus? Herodias. Okay. Now, Herodias was a historian that lived shortly after the time of Nebuchadnezzar. He lived in the period between Nebuchadnezzar and Alexander the Great, okay, in the 4th century B.C., and while he was alive, guess what was standing? The tower. And the reason it was standing is even though it had fallen in disrepair, okay? Even though it had fallen in disrepair, it was still there. And when Nebuchadnezzar decided to build his capital city, he built it in Babylon, and the tower was still there, but it was left in disrepair. And according to several historians, that the top of the tower had been knocked off by an earthquake and lightning. A bolt of lightning had hit the top of the tower and knocked it off. Okay? And Nebuchadnezzar comes along, and you know what he does? He finishes the tower. He did. He finishes the tower. And when he finishes the tower, he does it to glorify himself.
Of course.
Himself. In fact, if you go to the book of Daniel, actually, let's go there. Hold, put something in Zephaniah because we're coming back. Let's go to the book of Daniel. The only book in the Bible that Daniel didn't write in his little book here. Daniel chapter 4. And after Nebuchadnezzar finishes building this city and this tower, now it doesn't mention the tower here, but you know, the root word in the word tower is gadol. So we're seeing that Nebuchadnezzar is exalting himself here. And remember what Nebuchadnezzar says? Is this not what? That's right. In fact, if you want to actually see the quote, it's in verse 30. Well, let's look at verse 29. Let's look at verse 29. At the end of 12 months, he walked in the palace of the kingdom of Babylon. So he's in his palace, right? The king spake and said, Is not this great Babylon that I have built for the house of the kingdom by the might of my power and for the honor of my majesty? Is that self-exaltation? So Nimrod builds the first tower for what? Self-exaltation, right? Nebuchadnezzar finishes this tower for what? Self-exaltation. Do you believe that there could be a triple application of prophecy here? In order for there to be a triple application of prophecy, in the first application, God comes down, right? In the last application, the mighty angel of Revelation 18 comes down. I wonder if something happens like this to Nebuchadnezzar. Turn with me to chapter 4. Verse 13. Chapter 4, verse 13. Daniel. Daniel chapter 4, verse 13. Talking about Nebuchadnezzar here. And this is Nebuchadnezzar speaking. I saw in the visions of my head upon my bed, and behold, a watcher and holy one did what? Came down from heaven. Brothers and sisters, we have a triple application of prophecy right here. Right? So in Genesis chapter 11, God comes down because there's this tower built to glorify self. Nebuchadnezzar builds this tower, finishes the tower, and builds a city. So you have a city and a tower. You have a city and a tower. And at the end of the world, you have a city and a tower. And in this right here, what happens? A holy one comes down from heaven. That's triple application. And it all has to do with what? Self-exaltation and pride. Amen? Now, could there be a loud cry involved? Because, see, remember, there's a loud cry when the angel of Revelation 18 comes down, right? Look at verse 14. He cried aloud. Sounds like a loud cry to me. And said, thus, hew down the tree. So something's got to fall. Amen? You see all the parallels here? Okay. I had to give you a little bit of that history right there because we're going to watch this little video clip right here. And, you know, these are downloaded from offline and stuff. I'm not sure. I mean, like, they're from, well, you'll see. It's like History Channel stuff. So, History Channel, if you're watching this, I'm giving you a plug. And I'm not, this is not for sale. This is.
Glaser started renovating the Tower of Babel. His son Nebuchadnezzar completed it in the year 605 BC. He wrote in an inscription, a former king built it, they reckon 42 ages, but he did not complete its head. Since a remote time, people had abandoned it without order expressing their words. Since the time, the earthquake and the thunder had dispersed the sun-dried clay. The bricks of the casing had been split, and the earth of the interior had been scattered in heaps. Merodach, the great god, excited my mind to repair this building. I did not change the site, nor did I take away the foundation. In a fortunate month, in an auspicious day, I undertook to build porticos around the crude brick masses and the casing of burnt bricks. I adapted the circuits and put the inscription of my name in the kitter of the portico. I set my hand to finish it and to exalt its head as it had been in the ancient days. So I exalted its summit. The temple once again was destroyed in 484 BC during the suppression of a revolt against the Persian king Xerxes. Famous Greek historian Herodotus wrote about this structure in detail. In the 4th century BC, when Alexander the Great conquered Babylon, he dismantled the structure, which was in total disarray, in order to rebuild it. However, his death came too soon. He died young, at the age of 33. The project was never completed. The remains of this tower is there today in Babel Governorate of Iraq, and is now called Bis Nimrud, identifying it with Nimrod. The Greeks called it Borsippa, which means Tongue Tower. Since the beginning of the 19th century, many archaeological excavations have been carried out in this site. Until recently, an Austrian team explored this site in the year 2002, hoping to unearth a library of cuneiform tablets, which they have read about elsewhere. Well, if this structure is so historical...
Okay, I'm going to stop right here. So here's the thing. By the way, since that little video right there, they've made some more discoveries. They've actually discovered a stone with the carving on it of the Tower of Babel. And guess who's on the stone?
Nebuchadnezzar. And, oh, what happened there? I must have hit something.
Okay.
Now, so here's the thing. According to the Greek historian, Herodotus? Herodias, okay. According to him, this structure was 610 feet tall. And unlike a lot of us kind of grew up seeing this spiral kind of structure, it wasn't. It was square. Very fascinating. It had 8 different levels. They didn't have elevators, and you had to walk up. And it took so long to walk up to the first level that they had resting areas for people to relax and sit down until you got the energy to walk up to the next level and so on and so forth, right? So this, again, a clip from the History Channel. And I want you to especially pay notice as the archaeologist at the end gives the reason for the construction of this tower.
All right, why isn't it coming up? Oh, go back. That should pull up and play.
Turn slides on.
Oh, here we go.
The Ishtar Gate stood at the start.
Can you guys hear?
That led to Babylon's many temples and shrines, and its crowning glory, the Ziggurat. This was a spectacular temple, 650 feet tall, known as the Tower of Babel.
Ziggurats throughout Mesopotamian history, they're a sign of religious architecture. They're massive structures. They take a lot of man hours to build. Only a king with power and wealth can initiate such a project and finish it. And the reasoning behind building the Tower of Babel seems to be personal glory as well.
So why do they believe that that building was built? Again, we're just laying out the evidence, right? Okay, let's get some more evidence. I mean, for me, this is really where it gets exciting. Because not only are there all these parallels in the Bible that this is the fact. Okay, that right there is the foundation of the Tower of Babel. Today. That's what's left. Now, what's fascinating about it, did you notice in the quote from Nebuchadnezzar? He said that...
Boy, the Babylonians, they don't tear up their own foundations. Amen? So what happens here is this right here is what's left of the Tower of Babel. And according to the historians, remember who? What did they say? Who took it apart? Alexander the Great took it apart, and he wanted to rebuild it, but what happened? Premature death. If Alexander had gotten a chance to rebuild it, you think he would have been doing it for self-exaltation?
Yeah.
I think so. Here's the site. Down here, you see where it says Tower of Babel Mound? Mm-hmm. There's where the Tower of Babel is, and you see up there where it says Babylonian Palace, Babylon Palace? Well, that's where Nebuchadnezzar's palace was. So when he was out there on the portico saying, "Is this not the great Babylon that I have built?" What do you think he was looking over? That kind of gives you a feeling for the whole scenario that was going on there, right? Ooh, what's this? That's called the Twin Tower Memorial. The Twin Tower Memorial, you see, there are two holes in the ground there. They had a competition of sorts trying to figure out what the best memorial was going to be for those towers. You guys remember when all that was going on? So what they settled on here was that they were going to make two holes in the ground, perfect squares, and fill them with water. They're not got water in them there. They were going to fill them with water to illustrate where, you know, where the towers were. Okay? Do you see that right there? Down there where the arrow is?
Yeah.
Again, that's where the Tower of Babel was.
Big swimming pool.
There it is a little closer. So there's the Tower of Babel, and no man filled it with water.
Does it got water in it?
It has water in it. The foundation area where the stones were laid has been filled up with water. You see it all around here? Hence the green vegetation that's growing around the ring of it. You see what I'm saying here? Again, laying out the evidence. This is the Tower of Babel. There is the World Trade Center. I mean, we can't make this kind of stuff up, right? This is a fact. There is the Tower of Babel mound site. Still in the city. There's even a road next to it. You see where they built that road next to it? There it is. It's square. See the road next to it? There it is closer. You can get an idea of how massive this building was by looking at the highway that's next to it. And you see the little cars? That puts it in scale. Friends, if that isn't almost... totally this. The Bible says, "Therefore the wild beasts of the desert with the wild beasts of the islands shall dwell there, and the owl shall dwell therein, and it shall be no more inhabited forever, neither shall it be dwelt in from generation to generation." The reason I put this quote in here is because this prophecy from the time of Jeremiah has never failed. It has never failed. Okay? If people had gone here and started dwelling here again, we could say, no, the prophecy has failed. He couldn't do it. He couldn't do it. In fact, you know, the Bedouins that travel in and around this area, they won't even go and stay in this area at night. Okay? They won't even go there. So if this is the case, if this is what the Bible is telling us about the first Babylon, then the Babylon in Revelation chapter 18 has to be a different Babylon. Isn't that true? Now, look at this. You see this? Has the trees around it even? Look at that. Seriously, friends. Isaiah chapter 32, verse 14. Because the palaces be left, the forts and towers shall be dens forever, a joy of wild asses and a pasture of flocks. This is almost a paraphrase of talking about Babylon, but it's talking about the end of the world, and it's talking about these towers. And let me ask you a question. Most of us here are old enough to remember 9/11 pretty well. And we saw again and again them playing what happened on 9/11. But one of the things that happened that they didn't play a lot of was in the Islamic countries. How many people have ever seen videotape of the Seattle Seahawks winning the Super Bowl? And people going crazy and jumping up and down on cars and all this kind of stuff, right? Okay. When those towers in New York fell down, they were in the streets, they were jumping on cars, they were beeping horns, they were celebrating, right? Oh man, it was a joyful event, wasn't it, for them? Was it a joy of wild asses? Is wild ass a representation of Islam? So again, we're laying out the evidence, right? So let's kind of review some of the evidence right here. Unless I've missed something, there's a perfect chiastic structure with the first tower and the last towers. There's even a triple application of prophecy in regard to when the tower was rebuilt by Nebuchadnezzar, right? Then we start looking at the evidence in regard to why the tower was built. Glorify man. Glorify self. Why was the World Trade Center built? Glorify man. Glorify self. Both structures were destroyed and came down. Both structures are holes in the ground. Both structures are square. Both structures are full of water. One structure is in New York that Ellen White says that this is what will happen when Babylon has fallen, when these great buildings fall. And the other one is found in Babylon itself. That's a lot of evidence, isn't it? Let's keep going. We're going to address this next issue. I told you I would address the towers first. And we're going to have to go back to Zephaniah. Zephaniah chapter 16, chapter 1, verse 16. Chapter 1 and verse 16. Zephaniah chapter 1, verse 16. Again, we're going to read it, and we address the high towers, but in order for us to really understand the high towers in the context of what's being said, we have to address the fenced cities, okay? So let's just kind of read verse 16 again, and I'm not going to say that we've addressed the high towers. I'm going to say that I've laid some evidence down as to what the high towers represent. Because it's not until we pair up the fenced cities and the high towers that we can really get the whole picture. Okay? A day of the trumpet. We've all agreed that we've been living in the day of the seventh trumpet since October 22, 1844. An alarm against the fenced cities and against the high towers. Okay? So we're going to deal with a fenced city. What is a fenced city? It's a fortress. It's a military fortification, but it's also a fortification that people live in. Okay? So, what I've done here is I went online and I pulled out some images of fenced cities. And fenced cities aren't always one shape or another. But they're always designed in such a way where they can be defensible. Okay? There's another one. Notice a lot of times that they will come to a point like that, and that has to do with being able to defend the walls. If you go out on the point and people are trying to climb ladders up the walls or whatever, you can kind of reach over and shoot them or, you know, throw spears at them from that point out there. And whereas a square tends to have, like, blind spots in it. There's another one. That happens to be an American one. There's another one. And I'm going to give this illustration. The Pentagon, and unless something has changed since I've heard, that most people probably don't realize that the Pentagon is the largest building on Earth. The Pentagon, just the corridors, that means the hallways, not the office space, just the hallways, are 17.5 miles long. 17.5 miles. Yeah, I'll play it. If you kind of see this right here, notice this. Notice that these fenced cities have a certain look to them. In fact, there's a Pentagon with the points out on the end. I forgot what those things are called. And when the designers of the Pentagon were trying to figure out what shape or how to design this thing, well, what they did is they went to a fenced city design and they incorporated it into this office building. And by the way, this thing is heavily fortified. Yeah. And it is the headquarters of the United States Department of what? Defense. So even the title of its name is in there. Now, how many people knew that the Pentagon has a mayor? Has a mayor. Yeah. And we'll get into this in a little bit.
So do people live in there?
The Pentagon is occupied 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And if you worked there, you would feel like you were living there, right? This is going to go somewhat fast, but the reason I incorporated this particular little clip right here, it's going to show you everything that went into the Pentagon, but I want you to especially pay attention to the last part, okay? It's going to go fast.
Now, hopefully, how did I do this thing before? There we go. There. Can you guys hear that with that? We don't even need the music on this one.
Yeah.
All right, it's coming up right here. Today, the Pentagon functions as a city in itself. So there, you have 23,000 employees in that. So, again, what we're illustrating here, that by any human reason,
is a city, isn't it? When you have a mayor, when you have everything that it has, it's a city. And it's a defense city. It's a military fortification, right? Okay, so there's one part of the evidence, right? So what we have is we have towers, we have the seventh trumpet, we have one defense city, but notice in the text here, it says, a day of the trumpet and alarm against the fenced cities and against the high towers. So there are towers, plural, and there are cities, plural, right? So in order for this to fit 9/11, there has to be not one, but there has to be two fenced cities, defense cities. Okay, this right here is a map. This here is another one. This here is another one. And what you guys are looking at is Manhattan when it was originally built. When it was originally built, they built the first fenced city down at the lower bottom. You see that fortress right there? Okay. Not too far away from where the World Trade Center was built. Okay. As this thing grew, and by the way, you know who built this place? The East India Company. You ever heard of them? Well, Dutch. The East India Company, not only was it a corporation, it was a military corporation. Okay? And they built this thing right here to be their economic headquarters in the New World. This was going to be their chief of economic operations. And as people came over from Europe and it grew and grew and grew, you couldn't fit in the fort anymore for protection because you had Indians and invaders, you know, coming and stuff. So what they did is they fortified the whole place. And what they did is, you see this right here? You see this wall? They built this giant wall there called the Great Wall. And they built a road next to the wall so that they could get to all the different places on the road quickly. And that road is still there today. It's called Wall Street. Wall Street. So New York City was built as a fenced city. So what you have here is you have, and we're just weighing out the evidence here, okay? We have what we already talked about the towers. We talked about the chiastic structure. We talked about Ellen White, what she says about the towers. And we talked about what Ellen White specifically says about New York City. And in Testimonies Volume 9, let's turn there. Testimonies Volume 9. This is what Ellen White says. Oh, page 12. On one occasion when I was in New York City, I was in the night season called upon to behold buildings rising story after story. These buildings were warranted to be fireproof, and they were erected to glorify their owners and builders. There it is, right? Okay. In the context of this. She goes on to explain how these buildings are built and the reasoning behind it. And after the Lord shows her all these things, she says, the scene that next passed before me was an alarm. An alarm. Now let's go back to Zephaniah chapter 1 and verse 16. We all agree that there was a trumpet. Right? Does Ellen White say when these buildings fall, there's an alarm? Yes or no? Yes. And it was against the fenced cities. Were there two fence cities on 9/11 that were attacked? Absolutely. That's a fact, isn't it? Were there alarm against both of them? Absolutely there was, because there was destruction and fire at both locations, and the alarm of the fire department went out, and the fire department, both in the Pentagon area and in the New York area, the firemen come. And what does Ellen White say here? Men looked at the lofty and supposedly fireproof buildings and said they are perfectly safe, but these buildings were consumed as if made by pitch. The fire engines could do nothing to stay the destruction. The firemen were unable to operate the engines. In fact, if you have any knowledge at all of fire departments, if there's a really bad fire and an alarm goes out, but if it gets bad or worse, they send out a second alarm, right? It's called a two-alarm blaze. And if it gets worse, it's called a what?
A third
alarm. Well, you know, on 9/11, every fire department was sent out. And they weren't able to do anything. They couldn't do anything. And the fire department and alarm was sent out in both locations. Isn't that true? So we have the trumpet. That's fulfilled, right? The trumpet. And you know, if the Lord illustrates the end from the beginning, where was the first story of trumpets being blown in the Bible? Jericho, right? So they marched around the city seven times, and then they blew the seventh trumpet, and there was a loud cry, because remember, they were to blow the trumpet, but only on the seventh trumpet were they to cry out loud. So at the seventh trumpet, there's a loud cry, and when the cry goes out, what falls? The towers. And if you go into Patriarchs and Prophets, Ellen White says there were towers there. Did you know that? That there was towers. That's right. A fenced city and high towers. I'm not sure. You know, that's a good question. Now that has to be found out. Amen? I'll say it. What my sister said was, I wonder how many alarms went off if it was seven alarms. You know, was it a seven alarm fire?
And it comes down on the seventh. After they're called,
right.
It just comes down.
Right, exactly. That would be, I mean, you know, this is pretty heavy stuff, right?
Yeah.
So again, what I'm doing here, I'm not trying to turn over anybody's theories of what this means, right? But have we not laid out the evidence? I mean, this is a pretty heavy amount of evidence, right? Isn't it? There are two fenced cities. There are two towers. The chiastic structure, the firemen, the alarm, the trumpet in Jericho. And by the way, the similarities don't end there, because it says here that in verse 12, it shall come to pass at that time I will search Jerusalem with candles. In verse 12, that's the church. And what happens in the story of Jericho, when the walls of Jericho fall, what's the next thing that happens? They go out and try and take Ai, right? Let's go there. Let's in the book of Joshua. Because really, this is what it all comes down to for us.
Okay, so back in Zephaniah, I just wanted to say that in verse 17, their blood's poured out of dust.
Yeah, and that literally happened.
And then in 18, their silver and gold couldn't deliver economic collapse.
Yeah, in fact, if you go up to verse 11... If you go up to verse 11 of Zephaniah, what does it say? How ye inhabitants of Maktesh, for all the merchant people are cut down. All they that bear silver are cut off. And if you do a little bit of investigation, you'll realize that one of the places in the whole world where gold and silver was traded was, guess where? The World Trade Center. In fact, how many people know that a large supply of the world's gold and silver were actually kept at the site? And after Huh? What's that? Yeah, and after the disaster, they had to go in there to get it out. Why? So that there wouldn't be economic destabilization from...
Did they find it?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, it was in vaults underground. And they were, I mean, I don't know if you guys remember some of the stories, but some of the firemen were accused of coming across certain things and taking them and stuff like that. But anyway. Right. So good point. So let's go to the book of Joshua. The book of Joshua. So in the story of Joshua here, and for time's sake, what time do I have to quit?
You don't.
You got
20 minutes. 20 minutes? Okay. In the story here, what happens is that the walls of Jericho come down, right? And God is telling the people to go and possess the land, right? They've got a work to do. They've got a work to do to possess the land. And when God sent them into Jericho, they weren't to touch anything. They weren't to touch anything and take it for themselves, right? But somebody does. And let's look at Joshua chapter 7, verse 1. But the children of Israel committed a trespass in the accursed thing. For Achan the son of Carmi, the son of Zabdi, the son of Zerah of the tribe of Judah, took of the accursed thing, and the anger of the Lord was kindled against the children of Israel. What we do affects everybody. Isn't that true? Verse 2, and Joshua sent men from Jericho unto Ai, which was before Beth-Aven, on the east side of Bethel, and spoke unto them, saying, go up and view the country. And the men went up and viewed Ai. And they returned. Now notice this, when the Lord first sends men to view the country, they're like, oh, we can't take the place. Notice what they're saying here. And they returned to Joshua and said unto him, let not all the people go up, but let about 2,000 or 3,000 men go up and smite Ai, and make not all the people to labor thither, for they are but few. Was that a little bit of pride going on right there? Look what we just did. Did they do it, though? Verse 4. So there went up thither of the people about 3,000 men, and they fled before the men of Ai. And the men of Ai smote them about 36 men, for they chased them from before the gate even unto Shebarim, and smote them in the going down. Wherefore their hearts of the people melted, and they became as water. That's a disappointment. And Joshua rent his clothes and fell to the earth upon his face before the ark of the Lord. Do you know Ellen White makes a parallel right here? It's the midnight cry. Because in the midnight cry, we're to rip our hearts and not our garments. Joshua rent his clothes and fell to the earth upon his face before the ark of the Lord until eventide, and he and the elders of Israel, and put dust upon their heads. And Joshua said, alas, O Lord God, wherefore hast thou at all brought this people over Jordan to deliver us into the hand of the Amorites and to destroy us? Would to God we had been content to dwell on the other side of Jordan. O Lord, what shall I say when Israel turneth their backs before their enemies? For the Canaanites and all the inhabitants of the land shall hear of it and shall environ, what is that word? Encircle us. And cut off our name from the earth, and what wilt thou do unto thy great name? And the Lord said unto Joshua, get thee up, wherefore liest thou upon thy face? And believe me, friends, I think the Lord's telling this to us right now. Israel hath sinned, and they have also transgressed my covenant, which I commanded them, for they have even taken the accursed thing, and have even stolen and dissembled, that means lied, and they have put them among their own stuff. So what do you think is going to take place here? Verse 14. In the morning, therefore, ye shall be brought according to your tribes. It shall be that the tribe which the Lord taketh shall come according to the families thereof, and the family which the Lord shall take shall come by households, and the households which the Lord shall take shall come man by man. And it shall be that he that is taken with the accursed thing shall be burnt with fire, and he and all that he hath, because he hath transgressed the covenant of the Lord, and because he hath wrought folly in Israel. So Joshua rose up early in the morning and brought Israel by their tribes. And the tribe of Judah was taken. And he brought the family of Judah, and he took the family of the Zarhites, and he brought the family of the Zarhites man by man, and Zabdi was taken. You know what this is right here? This is an investigation. Yeah, it's a search going on right here. Did the person that did this have time at this point to come forward? He did. And he brought the family of Judah, and he took the family of the Zarhites, and verse 17, and he brought the family of the Zarhites man by man, and Zabdi was taken. And he brought his household man by man, and Achan the son of Carmi, the son of Zabdi, the son of Zerah of the tribe of Judah was taken. This was a process, friends. There was a lot of people here. And they were going literally tribe by tribe, household by household, man by man. And absolutely. And Joshua said unto Achan, my son, give, I pray thee, glory to the Lord God of Israel, and make confession unto him, and tell me now what thou hast done. Hide it not from me. And Achan answered Joshua and said, indeed I have sinned against the Lord God of Israel, and thus have I done. And when I have... And I saw the spoils a goodly, what? Hold on a second. Hold on a second. Weren't we talking about Jericho? What kind of clothes are they wearing in Jericho? It's coming full circle now, isn't it? We have Babylon, and it's buried in the midst of Israel. Amen? And 200 shekels of silver and a wedge of gold. Weren't we just talking about gold and silver in the book of Zephaniah? I coveted them and took them, and behold, they are hid in the earth in the midst of my tent, and the silver under it. So Joshua sent messengers, and they ran under the tent, and behold, it was hid in his tent, and the silver under it. And they took them out of the midst of the tent, and brought them unto Joshua, and unto all the children of Israel, and laid them out before the Lord. And Joshua and all Israel took Achan, the son of Zerah, and the silver, and the garment, and the wedge of gold, and his sons. Now look what happens here. Look what happens. And the wedge of gold, and his sons, and his daughters, and his oxen, and his asses, and his sheep, and his tent, and all that he had, and they brought them unto the valley of Achor. And Joshua said, why hast thou troubled us? The Lord shall trouble thee this day. And all Israel stoned him with stones, and burned them with fire, after they had stoned them with stones. An investigative judgment that takes place after the sound of the seventh trumpet, during the loud cry, when the Lord goes house by house by house, because Israel can't advance into the future as long as we have the sins of Babylon buried in our lives. Right now, we're in the investigative judgment. You can't make up this stuff. It's all fitting together like a glove. The towers, the investigative judgment, the judgment of the living. We're in the judgment of the living. And unless we can fall before the Lord and confess our sins and allow the Lord to remove, nay, I say, Babylonian garments out of our lives and from our hearts, we will suffer the same fate as Achan, and not only us, but everybody that's in our household and all of our possessions. But you know, there's a silver lining in this story. Because, did you know that there was somebody to take Achan's slot? Yeah. Did you know Ellen White talks about there's going to be a shaking, right? But then what's going to happen? People go out, people come in. Turn with me to Joshua chapter 6. Joshua chapter 6 and verse 21. Joshua 6, 21. And the Bible says, "And they utterly destroyed all that was in the city, both man and woman, young and old, and ox and sheep and ass, with the edge of the sword." Doesn't that sound just like what happened to Achan? Because, see, Achan, when he became part of Babylon, he deserved the same what? Fate, right? The same treatment. But notice this, verse 22. "But Joshua had said unto the two men that had spied out the country, Go into the harlot's house, and bring out thence the woman and all that she hath, as ye swore unto her. And the young men that were spies went in and brought out Rahab, and her father, and her mother, and her brethren, and all that she had, and they brought out all her kindred, and left them without the camp of Israel." So here's what we have. God has a remnant that are still where? In Babylon. And this woman was a harlot, right? But she was true, wasn't she? And so God's people are still in the city. Right? And God is going to have a rescue operation to bring them forth. And so what's going to happen is that this is all going on simultaneously. As she's being saved, Achan's being what? Taken out. His probation is over. He buried the thing under his tent. Amen? He gave up his seat at the table, and a harlot took his place. Isn't that amazing? Friends, I'm just laying out the weight of the evidence. And yeah, amen. And you know that she was actually in the lineage of Jesus. I had a couple more little videos, but I think we're out of, a couple more little slides, but we're out of time, right?
7 minutes.
7 minutes? Some more evidence here. This video was taken around 1970, so it's 1970-ish in its thing. But what it's going to tell you here is the whole reason why the World Trade Center was built, okay?
Okay, let's see here.
No sooner has one New York skyscraper risen above its neighbors than another is on its way to reach a little higher. In 1966, this area was raised to make way for the towers of the World Trade Center.
That's elevator music.
164 outdated buildings. Miles of telephone cables, pneumatic tubes, gas, steam, water, and sewer lines were relocated or removed.
Sorry for the music. It was a job just to remove everything they had to remove before they could start building.
In 1969, from 70 feet below street level, the first tower rose toward its 1,350-foot destination. The unique tower design permitted many building activities normally accomplished in sequence to take place at the same time. Large open areas free of columns are a major feature of the tower buildings. Closely spaced vertical columns provide the load-bearing strength instead of the customary interior steel skeleton. In late 1970, the last piece of steel for the tower was hoisted over a quarter mile into position atop New York's tallest building. The North Tower of the World Trade Center was topped out in December 1970. The South Tower was completed in 1971. The purpose of the World Trade Center is to increase the flow of international trade. It brings together 130,000 people each day, people of business and government involved in processing international commerce. The towers are occupied by the communications, financing, transportation, and education facilities required to carry on business more efficiently. At the World Trade Institute, businessmen and women from the world's trading nations study ways to expand and improve international trade. These towers are becoming the world headquarters, the United Nations of World Trade.
So, what does it do?
Bring you all the world together.
It brings people from all over the world to where? One place. Does that not fulfill the chiastic structure that was involved in the original Tower of Babel? Yes or no?
Yes.
Amen. Sorry. Remember, this is the first time I've done this. This is the last little clip. Do we have time? This clip right here is going to illustrate the towers themselves and the glory that they brought to man. Let's see here. Oh, sorry about this.
Go back to the last one. About that clip when you're done.
Okay.
Just that picture.
Hold on. Let's see. How do I get it back going to big again?
F5. Shift F5.
Okay, here we go. Did you hear 170 some thousand people a day?
Yeah. The fact that there was only 3,000 on 9/11 is amazing.
It is a miracle. Any other great buildings? Each floor was 1 acre, 110 stories. So it wasn't just that the buildings were tall, they were massive. Look how long it is just at the top.
looks so little in comparison now. Mm-hmm. 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 Mm-hmm.
Done? Do I have time to pray?
Yeah.
Let's pray.
Dear Heavenly Father, your prophet has told us to weigh out the evidence. And Lord, as we look at the evidence, piece after piece after piece after piece, from the foundation of the world till now, you're illustrating to us that judgment is in the land. During the time of the seventh trumpet, in the days of Joshua, towers fell, and there was an investigative judgment of your people, because they had to take the unclean thing from the midst of them so that they could go forward and possess the land. And Lord, that same judgment is occurring right now in our very midst. Angels of God are walking among us. The sealing is going on. And Lord, we need this accursed thing removed from us. This Babylonian garment needs to be taken off, and we need to put on the white robe of your righteousness and have our sin cleansed. Holy Father, we have a message to take to the world, and you've laid it out before us. The first, second, and third angel's message, and we've just looked at a little tiny bit of the evidence that you've given us on the second angel's message and the fall of Babylon and those buildings. Lord, we need to take this message to the world, because when it becomes known what the Bible says in these last days about these towers, it'll give great impetus to the work, and the work will move rapidly. Give us the tools and the knowledge to convey this message and to sound the warning. In Jesus' name, amen.